Well, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this webinar on income and wealth inequalities in the UK. I'm Paul Johnson. I'm director of the Institute for Fiscal Studies, and with particular reference to this event, I'm also a member of the Deaton panel, which is a huge project that we're running looking at inequalities very broadly defined. It's chaired by the Nobel laureate Angus Deaton, and we're very, very grateful to the Nuffield Foundation for funding this very large piece of work. We have, over the last year or so, been publishing a large number of papers based on the work that we've been doing, covering everything from issues in gender, gender inequality, education, the role of firms, the labour market, and so on. Today we are looking at essentially the level and trends in income and wealth inequalities in the UK over recent decades, something which is of course of huge interest. I should say that we our next event in this series will be on Monday of next week, when we'll be presenting work on race and ethnic inequalities. But today, I'm just really delighted. We've got three extraordinary speakers. We've got Mike Brewer, formerly of this parish, who is now chief economist at the Resolution Foundation and is one of the authors of the main chapter on this topic. He will be followed by Janet Gornick, who is professor of political science and sociology at City University, New York, and also director of the Stone Center there. And I think Janet will put some of what Mike says into a bit of international perspective. And then Stephen Jenkins, who's professor of economic and social policy at the London School of Economics. Stephen has been working, I know, on issues related to inequality for many decades. He and I first worked together probably back in the late 1980s, and he'd already been going a while by then. So it's a phenomenal set of presenters today. You should all have access to the Slido app and a link to that. So please put your questions for the speakers into that app, and do vote up questions you are keen on having answered. I will see the ones voted towards the top of the list first. I hope that our speakers are finished within about 45 minutes between them, and we will then have 45 minutes for questions and discussion. I will stop there and hand over directly to Mike Brewer.
Thank you very much, Paul. It was a delight to work on this project, which was joint with Pascal Bourquin, formerly at the IFS, and Thomas Wernham, currently at the IFS. So I think for many years, the traditional way of talking about inequality in the UK was to show this graph. And indeed, I've written many reports which have started with this graph. And this looks at income inequality in the UK using a couple of possible measures. In yellow, I show the 90-10 ratio. And in the dashed line, I show the Gini coefficient. These are just two ways of summarizing how unequal is the income distribution. The story is very clear, has been very clear for a long time. After a very large rise in income inequality in the 1980s, income inequality on these measures has been broadly static for about three decades now, going down slightly for the 90-10, but broadly static in the Gini. That's a simple story on income inequality. The simple story on wealth inequality. Now here I've switched measures. I'm looking at how much wealth is owned by the wealthiest 1%. In the early 20th century, that took astronomically high values, but we became more equal during most of the 20th century, bottoming out in about 1980. And since when, again, wealth inequality, as measured this way, top the share held by the wealthiest 1%, that hasn't changed either in about four decades. It's running at about 20%, plus or minus a few percentage points. So for many years, those were the main ways we thought about income and wealth inequality in the UK. But that leaves out, of course, a great deal, which is why I had the pleasure of writing 125 pages exploring this for the Deaton Review. And I wanted to bring out three things that are really left out from that simple story. First of all, levels are important, not just the change. If we think that inequality is bad for society, then it's because of the level of inequality, not because whether it's going up or down. And the UK definitely has one of the most unequal income distributions among comparable countries. And I will let Janet talk about that in her response. Secondly, as of course many of you know, just looking at a single summary measure of inequality hides a great deal. Yes, it is true that these single summary measures have not changed much over the last three decades, but bits of the distribution have become more unequal and bits have become more equal. And in particular, the top has continued to drift away from the rest of society over the last three decades. And I think Stephen will touch on that in his remarks. I will focus more of my attention on the third and fourth points. The third point is that both the measures I showed at the beginning were relative measures of inequality. They were looking at how much people had in income and wealth compared to other people. But absolute differences, as in differences in pounds, are also important. They're important for income because household incomes have really been growing very slowly since about the mid-late 2000s, and in contrast to the decades that preceded it. And they're important for wealth, where the opposite is happening. The amount of household wealth is growing very much more quickly than income. And indeed, it's doubled in importance since the early 1990s. And so we're seeing larger and larger absolute gaps in wealth. So in a minute, I'll explore those two points in more detail. And then I think what we've highlighted in our headlines this morning, what you may have seen, is that it's when you explore the detail of income inequalities and wealth inequalities together, you can really see new generational differences emerging. And the summary is that the surge in asset prices that the UK has seen, well, in housing since the 1990s and in other assets, maybe more recently, and the absence of wage growth that the UK has seen since the mid-2000s, has completely turned around the usual pattern we expect when we compare different generations, different birth cohorts, standard of living and wealth. And I will show that in more detail. So the first of my two points is about levels being important. And here the key point is to emphasize just how poor has been income growth across the distribution of income in recent decade and a half. So this graph shows how incomes have changed at different points in the income distribution over different periods of time. You can see how the 1978 and 1991 period was very different from the others. That was where the higher was your income, the more was income growth. The income distribution just stretched out. But then the key point really is how weak income growth has been since 2008. With average annual income growth of less than 1% at basically all points of the distribution. So, yes, inequality may not have changed, summary measures of inequality may not have changed very much, but also nor is the level of incomes changing very much. And that feels different from being in a society where incomes are growing at a robust 2% a year. As I said, for wealth, the opposite is happening. So wealth, or the amount of wealth owned by households, is growing rapidly compared to the total income in the economy. So since in 1991, the stock of household wealth, that's pensions, housing, and financial assets, was about 3.5 times the size of GDP, our national income. It's now 7 times as large as GDP. And that very large change has been mostly due to capital gains, in other words, by assets becoming more valuable, than it is due to households actively saving money. And that's extremely important, as I'll show in this chart. So in this chart, I'm going to show you in detail about the levels of wealth held by different people at different points in the wealth distribution. We only have good data from the middle of the 2000s, and this report was finalized slightly before the most recent data came available. So I'm looking at changes in wealth over a 10-year period, split into different kinds of wealth. This is what's happened to pension wealth over that decade, which is actually where we saw the biggest change in wealth in between the 2000s and 2010s. This is what happens to property wealth, and this is what happened to financial wealth. Now, actually, these changes to wealth happened at a time when summary measures of wealth inequality were flat. So if you were to look at this fraction of wealth going to the top 1% or the top 10%, if you were to look at the Gini coefficient of wealth, it hadn't changed over this 10-year period. But the amount of wealth owned by those who are at the top of the wealth distribution is clearly going up by a great deal. We can see a change in the pension wealth of the wealthiest 10% there of just shy of £200,000 over that decade. And whereas if you're at the bottom of the wealth distribution, your pension wealth has certainly gone up by nothing like £200,000. So perhaps a better way of thinking about changes in wealth is to look at those absolute differences and compare them to full-time earnings. I think this was done first by John Hills in his book about a decade or so ago. So here, what it boils down to, the killer statistic, is maybe the second one, the gap between the amount of wealth by somebody at the ninth wealth decile, so just below the middle, and somebody at the fifth wealth decile, just below the middle, and someone at the ninth wealth decile, towards the top. That gap has gone from about 10 years of typical full-time earnings in 2006 to 16 years of typical full-time earnings. And there's another way of pointing that fact out in the bullet above. And what that means is it's getting harder and harder, or essentially more and more impossible, to save your way up the wealth distribution. The only way you're going to get up the wealth distribution is by having wealth in the first place. So that's the kind of first point, one key conclusion, that levels are very important even when relative measures are unchanged. Now I want to bring out some of the differences by age and generation that we focused on in our, you may have seen in the headlines this morning. Now looking back at income, I'm going to show that the graph is going to show you what fraction of people of different ages were in the bottom 15% of the income distribution in a particular year. And I've shown just that the first two lines are for the late 1960s and the late 1970s. I don't quite know why the order is the wrong way around. But you can see a clear pattern that in the late 1960s and late 1970s, it was older individuals who were much more likely to be at the bottom of the income distribution. And that pattern has changed profoundly in the decades since. So here is the line for the early 1990s. Older people are still the most likely to be at the bottom of the income distribution, not by very much. The financial crisis era, and then the kind of pre-COVID era. And by that pre-COVID era, we have what is really a very flat or a very mild U-shaped pattern. Yes, it is the oldest individuals who are just about most likely to be at the bottom of the income distribution, but they're only slightly more likely than our children. So older people are now much better off compared to the rest of society than they were several decades ago. That's not because individual cohorts of older people have become better off. So in this chart, I'm going to show you the average income of people who are born in different decades and how that's changed through older working age life and into retirement years. So this is the line showing average income for those born in the 1910s. And as you can see, average incomes don't really change through retirement. They fall slightly in the late 50s as people drop out of the labor force, and then they're basically flat. And that's true for all the successive birth cohorts too. People born in the 20s, the 30s, the 40s, and the 50s. Amongst these generations, average incomes don't really change as you go through retirement and age. But what is changing dramatically is the difference between the cohorts, with every successive cohort being clearly better off than the ones that came before them. So we do look at the point where the five cohorts just about overlap. People in their late 50s, those born in the 1950s had real incomes that were about twice as high as those born in the 1910s at the same age. So that's the clear pattern of generation on generation progress that we saw for those born in the first half or so of the 20th century. And that has changed really quite dramatically since. So I'll now show you the same chart, but with more recent birth cohorts put on it. There are the oldest cohorts that I had on the previous chart, but going back to earlier ages. And here are the most recent cohorts. So if we were seeing generation on generation progress in income, a growth in living standards, we would see every line would be further to the top left than the ones preceding it. Where the lines cross, that means that a generation has not managed to get ahead of the generations that came before it. So you see that first of all for the 1960s cohort, who in their late 40s had the same income as people born in the 1950s at the same age, and then for the most recent cohorts on this chart, those born in the 1980s have got basically the same real incomes as people born in the 1970s when at the same age. There's no generational progress whatsoever. If we look at incomes after housing costs, then that pattern is accentuated. And you can see with the 1980s cohort at the very left, the dark green, they have lower incomes on average measured after housing costs than their immediate predecessors in the 1970s. And you can really see the sort of the lack of income growth over the life cycle for the most recent cohorts. I'm just going to flick back to the before housing cost one. And the fact we highlighted from this graph is that if you were born in the 1940s born in the 1940s or 1950s, if we measure the change in income from about their mid-20s to about the age of 50, so a 25-year period during the core of their working life, their real incomes approximately doubled. If you were born in the 1960s, then over the same period of your life, mid-20s to about the age of 50, your real income's up by about 50%, by a half rather than doubling. If you're born in the 1970s, you're on track to see, maybe if the trends go favorably for the last few years, you may be on track to see your income go up by a quarter over that 25-year period. So a really big slowdown in the extent to which particular generations can expect to see incomes grow as they age. And then what we point out in our report is that slowdown in income growth for young generations has also happened at the same time as the asset price boom. And the asset price boom has been bad for younger generations because it's made it harder for them to get on, for example, to get on the housing ladder. So this chart shows home ownership as people age for different birth cohorts. Starting with the 1930s cohort, the 1940s cohort there, the 1950s cohort, which is basically the sort of peak of home ownership. And since then, it's gone backwards slightly. There's the 1960s cohort, who are less likely to be homeowners now than their predecessors, the 1970s cohort, and the 1980s cohort, who are well behind. And basically, as you can see, they're following the track of the 1930s cohort. So sort of no progress in home ownership over a 50-year period. That's very dramatic. And what that means, if we see the same thing if we look across the income distribution. So this is the fraction of working age adults who own their own homes by where they are in the income distribution. The position in 1968 is here. Home ownership grew during the 1970s and 80s. So and on this chart, the peak of home ownership is the early 1990s, which you can see here with the majority of better off households owning their own homes and still a majority of middle income households owning their own homes. Since then, we've fallen back. Here's the line for 2008. Here's the line for 2019, where only half of middle income households, so those in deciles 5 and 6, own their own homes, or equivalently half are renting. Again, a really profound social change, but it means that those people who are not on the housing ladder then are not benefiting from the asset price boom that the UK has had in the last few decades. So where does that leave us? A headline might tell us that relative measures of inequality hadn't changed then over the last 30 or 40 years, but the UK is one of the most unequal, has one of the most unequal income distributions among comparable countries. Rising asset prices, which we've seen for housing since the 1990s and for other assets, particularly since the financial crisis, are accelerating the gap between those with and without wealth and making it harder and harder for you to save your way up the income distribution, and has reversed the rise in home ownership and making home ownership seem much more unlikely for more recent cohorts. And those younger cohorts then have been hit by that double whammy of not being able to get on the housing ladder, finding it harder to accumulate wealth, but also being hit by the UK slowdown in productivity and earnings growth. And the combination there is leading to that profound reversal of cohort differences in living standards and wealth. And as I said, and this is worrying, this is worrying not only if you think that income inequality or wealth inequality is unfair right now, but with very good evidence that today's inequality is going to lead to tomorrow's lack of social mobility. And so this cycle of inequality will persist in the future. So that's all I wanted to say. I think if I hit that, I can now hand over to Janet.
Thank you very much. Let me just share my screen and just make sure that everything is visible here. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. I'm also going to just start the clock here. Thanks so much for inviting me. It's been a pleasure and a very interesting experience to be part of this Deaton project and also to be part of the session today. So let me tell you what I'm going to do in my few minutes here. First, I'm going to talk a little bit about the data that I'm turning to. I was invited that I'm going to be drawing on today. I'm sure we all know, or I know, I was invited to participate because I worked for a very long time with cross-national data and cross-national comparison. So I'm going to take just a few of the findings in this report and put them in cross-national perspective. Then I'm going to turn to some selected empirical results, and I'm going to compare findings both on inequality and also on poverty between the UK, the US, and four other high-income countries. And I'm going to do that at 5 points in time. So let me just jump right in. I do want to take a couple of minutes to talk about the data source here. And the reason that I want to do that is actually for two reasons. One is just to so you'll understand where the numbers come from that I'm discussing. But also, I think many of you are probably familiar with the data source and also with the data sets from the UK in particular. So I want to do this also to raise availability, to raise awareness of the availability of these data. And admittedly, I'm quite partisan because I've been involved with the production of the data for a long time. So the source of the data is, in fact, the LIST, the Cross-National Data Center in Luxembourg. And it's a data center that gathers data sets. The staff gathers data sets there from many countries over time. These data sets are based on, for the most part, household surveys, sometimes supplemented by administrative data. And the team in Luxembourg harmonizes them into a common template to render them as comparable as possible across countries and over time. Very briefly, LIST was founded in 1983 by a group of seven social scientists representing seven different countries. The UK was there from the very beginning. And the first version of LIST included seven data sets at one point in time, approximately 1980. And that, as I said, that included the UK, also the US, Canada, Germany, Sweden, Norway, and Israel. Today, LIST has grown enormously. The income data now include data from 50 countries. There are over 650 data sets, and those data sets, a data set meaning a country in a year, those cover the period, various years from 1971 to 2020. There's also a wealth database, newer and smaller, that includes 19 countries, a shorter period of time. In my comments today, I'm only going to refer to income-related results. So I do just want to mention that UK has been involved for a very long time, and there's a tremendous amount of data from the UK now included here. So there are 30 data sets of income data from 1969 to 2018. Two later years are in progress right now, and there are six wealth data sets. So take a moment to express gratitude to the UK, especially to the Department of Work and Pensions, and to ONS for many years of participation. And then before I jump into some findings, just to mention that the income data that you're going to see in the results that I'm showing are up until 1969 from the Family Expenditure Survey, and since then from the Family Resources Survey. There's also wealth data, although I'm not going to present it today, from the Wealth and Asset Survey. Okay, so let me just jump in now to show some illustrative findings. So what you're going to see here, what you do see here in this figure is five countries. I hope everybody can see that: Germany, Norway, Australia, Canada, US, and UK from left to right at these 5 points in time. And this is showing income inequality using the very common metric of the Gini, which I think probably most people are familiar with. A higher number refers to a higher level of inequality. What's important to note here is that this is inequality of post-tax, post-transfer income, which we often refer to as disposable income. What is that? That's income from the market, income meaning from the labor market, and also income from capital, plus transfers received by the household minus direct household taxes paid out. So we call that disposable income, or for the purposes of my comments today, I'll use both of those terms. So the report that I'm commenting on, I'll refer to as BBW, just to shorten it. Their results indicate that post-tax, post-transfer income inequality in the UK was remarkably stable between 1960 and 1980. And then it rose sharply between 1980 and 1990. And after that, it remained largely stable, rising a little bit and falling. So it was somewhat volatile. I report here a very parallel portrait. And one of the first things to say is that the results in our data slightly measured slightly differently, with some methodological differences that really don't matter too much today, were actually quite similar. So just for a brief moment, let me mention that all of the income results, income inequality results that I present here adjust for household size, which is important. Results are presented at the person level, meaning that these are inequality levels and poverty rates. When I get to the poverty, they refer to persons based on their household income. And importantly, for the inequality findings, I'm focusing on non-elderly households, meaning households with no members age 60 or over. Sorry, sirens here in New York. And the reason that I'm doing that is because I'm going to tell a story about redistribution, and it's very different for working age households and for elderly households and that elderly headed households. And that's something we can come back to in the Q&A if people wish to do that. So again, there are a few measurement differences between the work that I'm presenting here and the work in the BBW report, but I don't think they're important to mention too much today. The span of time here in general terms includes three periods. The first three points, 1980, 90, and 2000, precede the Great Recession. The 2000 time point corresponds more or less to the ending phase of the recession. And the most recent year, 2017, falls well into the post-recession recovery, but importantly, prior to the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic. Okay, so again, the results that I'm going to show you here track quite closely to what's in the BBW report. In the UK, we see inequality rose sharply between 1980 and 1990, after which it mostly stabilized, rising and then falling a bit. Inequality in the United States, in contrast, rose steadily between 1980 and 2017, and in all of these years exceeded the levels reported in the UK. So as noted earlier, the UK does have high levels of inequality in cross-national perspective, but in almost every measure in every year, lagging those reported in the United States. In the other four countries here, the overall pattern during this period was marked by increased inequality, was also marked by increased inequality, but country-specific trends vary within these years. If you look at a larger group of countries, our data and data from the OECD similarly find that post-tax, post-transfer inequality as captured by the Gini rose during this period of time in about two-thirds of the high-income countries in the OECD. Okay, so let me move on. This slide, the reason that I'm pausing to explain all this, this is where what I'm hoping to add to the BBW commentary, which is to step back from simply looking at post-tax, post-transfer income inequality to look at pre-tax, pre-transfer or market income inequality. And that gives us an opportunity to take a look from a particular perspective, to take a look at redistribution. Okay, so drawing on the data from LIS, we're able to look at pre-tax, pre-transfer inequality. We might call that market income inequality. So this indicator is calculated by starting with the income levels in figure one that are reported by the households and subtracting transfers received and adding back in the taxes paid. So this is, of course, a fictive measure, meaning that households don't actually experience these income levels. This approach, which is really common in the literature on inequality, enables us to look at redistribution via taxes and transfers. I'll say a little bit more about that in a moment here. So what we see here in this figure, in my figure two of this market or pre-tax and transfer inequality, a pattern similar to figure one in that the dominant cross-national pattern is rising inequality with a modest downward turn, as you can see in the UK after 2000. However, we also see increasing inequality here of greater magnitudes than reported in figure one between 1980 and 2017. Pre-tax, pre-transfer income inequality in the UK rose by 12 Gini points compared to an increase of 6 Gini points in the earlier figure. That indicates that redistribution as conceptualized here blunted the increase in market income inequality. The differences between figure one and two also reveal the varying impact cross-nationally of redistribution. For example, in contrast to the UK, inequality in the US rose by about the same increment in both pre and post, meaning that redistribution in the US was more limited during these years. So just taking a look at this from one more angle, this is once again, using this particular look at redistribution, the difference between pre and post is a proxy for redistribution. It's important to note, it's really an accounting exercise. I think it's an illuminating one to take a look at essentially what the state is doing to redistribute what the market produces. But again, it's really just a proxy. The pre results are hypothetical, taking no account of behavioral effects that would be expected if taxes and transfers were really withdrawn. Nevertheless, again, I would say it does give us a window on the inequality reducing effects of taxes and transfers over time. So here we see in the UK, redistribution nearly doubled between 1980 and 2010, rising from about 8 Gini points to 15, after which it declined very slightly. This increase in redistribution in the UK, of course, accounts for the finding that the post-inequality rose less than the pre. In other words, again, the increasing effects of taxes and transfers blunted the rising market income inequality. And the overtime portrait of increasing redistribution was similar in Germany, Norway, and Australia. Redistribution changed less in Canada and the US as well. To some extent, the UK results, and perhaps we would say those in Germany, Norway, and Australia, go against the grain of the story of the sort of widespread story of the collapsing welfare state or the collapsing power of redistribution. Let me just show you these same findings from one more angle. I'm afraid it's not a perfect visual, but just to look at this in a different way. Here we take a look, the horizontal axis reports, again, the pre-tax, pre-transfer or market income inequality that I showed in the second figure, and the vertical axis presents redistribution as captured by the difference between the pre and post. And this figure reveals overall that both when with, so just to mention, the UK is in the rather bright blue that you can see there. And this figure reveals overall that both within and across countries, pre-inequality, market income inequality, and redistribution tend to rise hand in hand. It also highlights that redistribution shifted downward after 2010 in the UK, the US, and Norway, a pattern that's not seen in the other three countries. Okay, let me move on. I just have a couple of minutes left. I want to just turn to another part of the BBW report that I thought was really interesting and but that I wanted to extend somewhat. They take a look at child poverty and pensioner poverty. In the BBW report, they're looking at, they use the definition of relative poverty, where a household is defined as poor if it's household size adjusted income level post-tax and transfer falls at less than 60% of the median from that country year. That was a bit of a mouthful, but the relative poverty rate at 60%, which is commonly used by Eurostat and in many other, in a lot of cross-national research and also in the policy sphere. Importantly, just to note, they first looked at the years 1960 to 1980, and there they find that child poverty remains steady, about 14 to 17%. Pensioner poverty started at a much higher level, nearly 40%, and then declined substantially, reaching a poverty rate in 1980 that was about twice that of child poverty. And the trends shifted after 1980. They found that child poverty rose sharply between 1980 and 1990, peaking, and then it stabilized. The important thing is, at the beginning of the period that they covered, pensioners were at much greater risk of poverty than were children, and that was still true in 1980. But this ordering then reversed with a final crossover seen in the early 1990s, and it has remained reversed for many years. As of 2017, in the UK, the child poverty rate was twice that of pensioners. And again, of course, this is from the pre-COVID period where in many rich countries, these numbers will shift. We can come back to that. So just turning quickly to the results from LIS, what we see here, what I did here was to look at three different thresholds, because I think it's pretty clear that the thresholds matter, and they matter quite a lot, and the policy implications, especially for targeting, are important. So I took a look at these three different, using the same income definitions, et cetera, just moving the thresholds. And in this world of poverty research, I'm using language that's fairly common, 40% corresponding to what we might call deep poverty, 50%, very commonly used by researchers in the LIS community, at 50%, and near poverty or perhaps at risk of poverty at 60%. So here I compare poverty levels and trends in the UK with those reported in the US, bringing into relief similarities and differences between these two frequently compared countries. So what do we see? I think the important thing to note is that in both countries, the 60% threshold includes or aggregates households experiencing very different levels of hardship. In 2017, for example, in the UK, the child poverty rate of the 60% threshold is 22%, as you can see here. About half of those households fall below 50%, and about a quarter fall into deep poverty. And in a fairly similar pattern in the US, but with notably higher child poverty rates, about two-thirds at the 60% threshold fall below the 50% threshold, and a full third fall into deep poverty. So my last slide, just to show similarly with elderly poverty, where the story is very different in terms of both levels and trends, As with child poverty, we see that the 60% threshold captures elderly poverty that's marked by diversity. In the most recent year I have here, 20% of the elderly were poor at the 60% poverty line. Half of those were poor at 50%, and a quarter fell into deep poverty. Again, those are, of course, that diversity is masked by using the single poverty line. Throughout the years reported here, deep poverty among the elderly was substantially more prevalent in the United States than in the UK. Poverty at the 50% threshold was also more prevalent in the US compared with the UK. At the 60% threshold, the position of the two countries reversed over time. In 1980, at 60%, elderly poverty in the UK was much higher than in the US. In 2017, we see a different comparison with US elderly poverty rates exceeding those in the UK at 27 and 20%, respectively. So the results I've commented here are really illustrative. My key point, again, is that these poverty thresholds matter, and they have obvious policy implications, especially with regard to targeting. So I'm going to close on that.
Hello, everybody. It's a privilege to be here today and to discuss this report. First of all, I think we should all get together and salute Mike and his colleagues. It's really produced an encyclopedic view about what's been happening over the last 50 years or so in the UK to inequality, and done it through so many different lenses. This is a great report. In fact, there's too much there for me to talk about. So what I'm going to do is just focus on one of the most commonly cited facts about UK income inequality. And this is exactly what they might put on the top of his second slide, the idea that income inequality has changed little over the last 30 years. And I'm going to basically bat that hypothesis about to consider its veracity. Why should I do this? Well, when I first came into this, the idea that inequality hadn't changed for the last 30 years seemed to be contrary to, as some of my colleagues would say, the lived experience of many people. So what the heck's going on? And I'm going to show you that there are some grounds for arguing that income inequality levels are definitely higher, but also that the inequality increase over time is greater than the conventional approach, such as those shown by Mike, indicates. So essentially, I'm going to do this by looking at several fundamental issues in inequality measurement. That sounds boring, yes, but I think fundamentals are important. Another way of thinking about it is that I'm going to be saying many of the same points as Mike, but just repeating them in a different sort of language. So let's get the ball rolling. The idea of this slide is to convince you that the way in which you summarize inequality in a given number really does affect your perception about trends in particular. So on the horizontal axis is time, of course. On the vertical axis, I've got inequality for these indices up in the shown in the legend, the Gini index and the ratio of the 90th percentile to the 10th percentile, and the share of total income that is held by the top 1% are, of course, shown by on Mike's various slides. I've added in something called the tile index, which is more sensitive to income differences at the top than at the bottom. I'll come back to that point shortly, but let me explain the construction of the graph. Essentially, I've normalized every value in a given year relative to its value in 1962. So essentially, because all these indices are shown in different scales, we need to make them comparable. So we start off from the same point, and essentially an upward trend means it goes up above one, decline goes below one. In the middle, we have for the squares and the rounds, the Gini and the 90-20 ratio, we've got Mike's pictures, slide two, and you can see, yes, not much happens. Big rise in the 1980s. And then bobbling around from the 90s on. That's three decades of stability. Nonetheless, you can see that compared to the beginning of the 60s, inequality, according to these measures, is about 40% higher, at least according to the Gini coefficient. However, I would direct your attention to the top 1%, a share of top 1% measure, which of course is very top income focused. Basically, if you're really worried about what's going on at the top, what you see is that the trend for the triangle series is a diamond series, a triangle is rather different from the squares. In fact, declining more, flat, rising at a different time, a bit starting later, and going up and continuing to go up after 1990, and then declining and then bobbling around a bit. This is even starker for an index such as the tile index, which is calculated using all incomes, including those below the 99th percentile. So, and perhaps it's better from that point of view. But you can see, again, trends differ. We get the rise in inequality basically going on and on. Sure, it's bobbling around in the last three decades, but you can see that it's definitely basically the trend is upward. So inequality trends depend on the inequality index. How you look at things matters. But then there are additional issues. You might say to me, well, those top 1% share data were based on income tax data, not the survey data that everybody else uses. Is that the reason? Is it something to do with the survey data and problems in the survey data that are leading to Mike's stability result? In particular, we find that surveys do not cover the top incomes particularly well. And so what happens if you adjust your measures, the survey data, to take account of this? Moreover, what happens if you change the definition of income? Because we also note that the definition of income that's used in the tax data differs from that that's used in the survey data. So basically, this is what I'm trying to explore here is whether or not this stability result is due to problems in the survey, the top income under coverage. I want to draw attention to some work by Rich Birkhauser and Nicolai Arrow, Roger Wilkins and myself, which it was a critique of the work done by the Department of Work and Pensions when preparing their data and reports. They've incorporated so-called SPI adjustment since then. So essentially what they do, given the undercoverage of very top incomes, is adjust around 0.5% of them using values that are spliced in from the tax data. And that adjustment, by the way, underpins Mike and his colleagues' data as well. The results of our research suggested that, in fact, 0.5% wasn't enough. You needed to do between 3% and 5%. You needed to take a better account of inequality within the top. So take a more granular approach at the top, do more adjustments, more means. And there are a couple of other points, but the first two were particularly important. As a proof of concept, we produced an SPI2 adjustment to see what happens. And this is relevant because our work lies behind the recent Office for National Statistics introduction of its own adjustment into its inequality series for the Living Costs and Food Survey. So just to give you an idea of the differences that it makes based on our work, using the ONS data from the Living Costs and Food Survey, you get this, the round blobs here, the dark series at the bottom. That's what the ONS estimates for the Gini coefficient if you don't do any adjustments to the survey data. On the other hand, if you incorporate the sorts of adjustments we were proposing over this time in various different ways, giving these different dotted lines, the level of the Gini, you can see, is clearly rather larger by more than 2 percentage points in many time periods, and that's a relatively large number. The Gini rarely changes by more than 2 percentage points a year. And also the trend is a bit different. For example, in the mid-2000s, continuing to go up, and some changes over here. So it does make a difference. The ONS has now gone on to produce a series that goes all the way back to 2001-2. This is shown in this chart with the square boxes. For comparison, I've stuck it next to the DWP's HBAI series. So this is exactly the same series as Mike and colleagues were showing. It's the one with the circles and dashed lines. The DWP's top income adjustment comes in 1992, and the ONS one from there. So when the DWP introduced theirs, inequality is higher because the ONS one is not adjusted. But now we've got the ONS making their adjustment, you can, and doing it in a more substantive way, because taking better account of top income under coverage, you can see inequality is rather higher by quite a lot, depending on the year, as we go into the Great Recession here. And you can see that the trends are slightly different, as we were showing before. And these are fairly reliable, because after in 2017-18, the data set that the ONS had used has been enlarged substantially. But note what's going on at the end here, this rising faster than it is in the DWP series. So the data, how you treat top incomes and reliability there does make some difference. Let's go back to the survey data again and think about whether or not it matters, whether or not we use a before housing costs income definition. That's what Mike focused on. It's what Janet showed in her slides. What happens if you used an after housing costs definition, which is often used for looking at poverty, not just inequality. So you can see, using the same DWP type data, that essentially the trends don't make any difference until up to the 90s. But then effectively the main big change that was going on here is change in the right to buy. And you see there's big jacking up of inequality in terms of the Gini coefficient at this point. And the series have changed a bit. I think you can discern perhaps a slight rise over time were you to smooth the after housing cost series, whereas the before housing cost one bubbles around. So changing the income definition does make a bit of a difference. Another thing you might say is, well, the income measure that we use doesn't include capital gains, but capital gains really do affect particular groups, in fact, the rich. So we should take account of that in terms of our income definition. This is not done regularly, but Aaron Advani and Andy Summers have done this recently and produced some estimates. So this is the top 1% share measure that I was showing before, essentially the benchmark estimates of this dark green one over the end. If you include capital gains, you get the red line, and you can see it jacks up the share by about 2 percentage points. And the trend at the end, okay, coming out here, just pre-COVID times, the slope of the red line is more distinctly upwards than for this other line. Moreover, coming back to pick up Mike's point about levels mattering, you can summarize income inequality not just in terms of shares, as with the usual Gini coefficient, but actually summarize the raw gaps between individuals, not expressing them relative to the mean. And what I show in this slide is three measures, the so-called absolute Gini, which is the dear old Gini coefficient, but not expressed relative to the mean, the 90th percentile minus the 10th percentile, so the absolute gap, not the relative gap, and the standard deviation, again, expressing them relative to the value in 1961. And of course, you get the rise in inequality, as we were seeing before, up to 1991. But I would draw your attention to the period after, in the last three decades. And clearly, each of those measures is showing a distinct rise over time. And to come back to my very first point, depending on which measure you choose, you get a larger or smaller rise. So, to put all things together, what we're finding is that UK income inequality levels are higher than conventionally assumed from the sort of pictures that Mike and others show. And the conclusion that income inequality has been stable over the last 3 years is sensitive to the choice of inequality index employed or inequality conceptualization. So my parting question is coming back to the sorts of things that Mike was raising, and my concern going into the originally into this topic are ongoing expressions of concern about income inequality in the UK. Are they due to worries about the rising levels of inequality itself, or is it secondly the corrosive effect of inequality remaining at relatively high stable level? Of course, compounded by the fact, as Michael said, that real incomes at the bottom of the distribution are not changing at all. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mike, Janet, and Stephen. A fantastically rich set of presentations. Really fascinating to see what Mike was showing about how wealth particularly distribution of change over generations and over time. I thought Janet brought out some really interesting international comparisons, and Stephen reminded us, and we occasionally do need reminding, of how important different measures are. Now, as you'd expect, we've got quite a number of questions here, and I will at least initially take them from the top down in terms of those which are being voted towards the top. I will ask first. And there are some really interesting ones. So the first one, which I think is very pertinent, asks, does looking at average income of birth cohorts hide more than it reveals? The inequality within some cohorts is massive, with differences by education, ethnicity, location, household type, and so on, showing contrasts for different cohorts, which I think is a really important challenge, because it's very easy to show those averages over time. But clearly, and I think I'm right in saying this, Mike, there is more inequality within any cohort than there is on average between them.
Yes, there is, absolutely. Yes. There's more inequality within all these cohorts than between them. Of course, you, Paul, and your colleagues on the Deaton Review are fully aware of this, and that's why you've commissioned 20 or so different chapters, many of which are looking at these different dimensions of inequality. You're looking at differences between different ethnicities, as you say, next week. You looked at gender inequality, differences in education, and so on and so on and so on. So this is, you should see this, dear reader, dear listener, as one contribution to that assessment of overall inequalities. But the point my point was partly that these differences between cohorts have changed their profile in really a dramatic way. That pattern for those born in the first half of the 20th century was incredibly clear. You were basically guaranteed to be better off than the generations that came before you, and that has changed. Something changed. Those born 1960 and onwards, that's just not quite as true anymore. And for the most recent cohorts, they're looking at no difference at all to their previous cohorts. Now, I think that's not the most biggest dimension of inequality. There will still be some people in recent cohorts who are doing very well, thank you very much, who have bought houses, who are in high paying jobs. But I think it's a combination of the slowdown in earnings along with the change into asset prices and home ownership is interesting. And although it's beyond the scope of this chapter to explore, I think there's a potential for it to have political implications. But yeah, absolutely, as the question said, there are definitely many other dimensions to inequality, and many of which indeed are covered in the full chapter.
Yeah, I think that point about political implications is really important. We've actually, in a few weeks, we're going to be launching another one of the Deaton chapters, which is on political inequalities, which draws attention to the role, for example, of changing home ownership rates and its impact on politics. As the saying goes, if you've got a generation without capital, you can't really expect them to be capitalists. And I think more broadly, if you've got a generation of parents who see their children growing up worse off than they were on average, you're also not going to have necessarily happy generations. Janet or Stephen, did you want to come in on this? I think it's quite an important sort of point. Nope, that's absolutely fine. The next question is from my old friend David Yendall, who I've worked with over many years on pensions issues. It's a bit of an old chestnut of a question, let's be honest, but it's always one worth coming back to. Does this analysis undermine the need for retaining the pensions triple lock? I'll come to you again first, Mike, but I don't know if Stephen wants to come in on that one.
I was going to say, I do applaud this democratic approach of taking questions, at least to start with. A question has been asked many, many times, and I also know, Paul, how you've replied to this. So, I mean, the really key point from our analysis, from my work, and indeed from others' work at the IFS, is that being old is no longer a strong marker for being poor. And whereas it was that definitely was the case 30 or 40 years ago. And anyway, there are still many things in the benefit system that are targeted by age, which seem to bring with it the sort of assumption that if you are 60 or 65 or over, then you will have a low income. And that's just not true anymore. It, it, the median income of pensioners and working age adults is very similar. And indeed, at the bottom of the distribution, because we have generous pension and benefits for pensioners, the 20th centile of pensioner income is higher than the 20th centile of non-pensioner income. So it is definitely no longer the case that the older people, being old is a marker for being poor. There's a little bit of a logical, that doesn't automatically mean that you don't need to triple lock the state pension. As it is, I think the triple lock is bad because of the ratchet effect anyway. If the question is, should we earnings index the state pension? I would say yes, but then I would also think that you should earnings index working age benefits. But I realize in giving that answer, I've perhaps taken us some way from what the original question might have had in mind.
Well, I think that's all to the good. Stephen, did you want to come in on this one?
No, I think Mike summarized it brilliantly. I was going to mischievously suggest Janet provide an answer, but I think that would be totally unfair.
Actually, I have my eye on the next question.
Me too.
So I'll hold off on triple pension lock. We'll wait.
Excellent. I'm glad you've got your eye on the next question, because I think this is really quite a difficult question. The link between high level of income inequality and weak growth in average incomes, are they related? I'm fascinated to hear both of you on that one. Well, Janet first. Oh, Stephen.
You can give the international perspective. I certainly you can interpret this question in many different ways, and it's clearly a really important question. It's about the age-old trade-off, as some people call it, between efficiency and equity, whether or not there is a trade-off between the size of the pie and the way it's sliced up. And this has been addressed by economists for years and years, and in fact even organizations like the International Monetary Fund and the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD, have got involved with it and written important studies about it. And I think the bottom line, and Janet will back me up or disagree, is that both the IMF and the OECD have produced reports where the bottom line is that higher levels of income inequality are associated with lower growth when you control for other stuff. And clearly that still remains a rather contentious conclusion, but I think that's where the balance of the research is at the moment. It's clearly a topic with great political resonance. Certainly, former Prime Minister Ms. Truss and her Chancellor were not concerned that there was any link at all. Basically, they were thinking about getting growth up and didn't care, famously stated they didn't care about what happened to inequality. So in a sense, there was an assumption that there was just a disconnect. But I think the more important thing is this body of research underpinned by international organizations' research.
Let me just add to that to say, indeed, this is an age-old question and a really important one. A few years ago, I was part of a group looking at this, and one of the participants reviewed the literature and came up with 4,000 studies asking this question about the impact of inequality and economic growth. I think the bottom line is both sides of the ledger have to really be disaggregated. It's a very complicated relationship. And just to go back, Joe Stiglitz, a name I'm sure many of you know, wrote a book a few years ago called The Price of Inequality, which had a lot of impact in the US here. And he argued that the reason we should be concerned about inequality is because it has negative impacts on other outcomes, you know, that are much less, that are not controversial, one of which is that it's a drag on economic growth. I think what the research shows, though, is that it really depends on where the inequality is. If you disaggregate, you know, when you run these regressions with the Gini on the right-hand side and some aggregate measure of growth, you know, as the dependent variable, you actually don't get too much. But when you disaggregate the Gini into where the inequality is, the top half versus the bottom half, you start to see that it actually really matters. There's no one universal answer. Other measures of inequality, for example, inequality in education or human capital also seem to have a strong impact. So it depends on what kind of inequality. And then just to comment on this, and in general, I think Stephen is absolutely right. The report from the IMF had a huge impact. In fact, Stiglitz himself used to joke that, you know, years ago, people thought this was sort of a claim of wild-eyed leftists, that inequality was bad for inequality. Was bad for growth, but when the IMF weighed in, it really shifted it to a much more mainstream claim. And just the last thing to say is that the questioner, I think, asked about growth in the middle. The other thing is that the the field of inequality change over time has shifted toward a distributional framework in recent years. We talk about inclusive growth or equitable growth. So the question is, where is the growth? And of course, what we know in the United States and the UK in recent years, you know, the economic growth was extremely unequally distributed, most of it being in the upper parts of the distribution. So I think the gross overall finding is that many find that income inequality is bad for growth, but it depends on what kind of inequality and growth where in the distribution.
Are you able to say anything about the mechanism? I mean, what is it? Do we know what it is about inequality that might lead to lower growth?
Well, that's a good question. I Stiglitz explains it mostly in terms of demand, that when the middle is that as inequality, if inequality is essentially taking the shape of, you know, moving income up in the distribution, that it's going to affect that there'll be a lack of demand in the middle. And so, in other words, people, you can only buy so many yachts and so many, you know,
I know
their apartments. Exactly. But when people in the middle can't buy milk and shoes and, you know, modestly priced homes, that's at least one of the, I think that's the main mechanism that he argues. That's also somewhat contested as to what the mechanism is, but I think the most common one, as I understand it.
Yeah. There are harder to test ones along the lines of the extent an indirect mechanism is that higher inequality leads to greater corrosiveness in the nature of social relationships and basically how the economy works, broadly speaking, and how things work also within firms, potentially. And that then has a knock-on effect in terms of growth. Clearly quite hard to pin down, but it's those sorts of conversations that people have.
Just to add to one more sentence to that, the conversation in the US, and I assume it's the same in many, I know it's the same in many other places, in recent years has become very instrumental. You know, we used to talk about inequality was bad because it was bad. It was unfair in a country as rich as the US. Now the conversation is almost entirely instrumental. That inequality is bad for growth. But as Stephen mentioned, it's bad for the democratic process. It's bad for intergenerational mobility. And then evoking the famous work of the spirit level years ago, it's bad for all kinds of outcomes, social cohesion. And of course, it's also bad for poverty. And all of those have implications for economic growth and for the distribution of that growth.
Great. There's a couple of questions here really about, which are probably mostly directed at you, Mike. I think broadly speaking, what's led to this growth in wealth? To what extent is it down to interest rate policy? To what extent is it down to earlier increases in earnings and earnings inequality? And is there a link, a direct link between what's been happening to wealth and what's been happening to earnings?
Yeah, also a very good set of questions, raising some very complicated issues. I'll start simple and then see how far I get towards the complicated ones. So the house prices have been going up since broadly the 1980s, albeit with like a dip in the 1990s when we had a recession. And fundamentally, the reason house prices are going up so much is because we don't build enough houses. Thinking about assets more broadly, the story I was telling is that the asset price growth was made worse or was spurred on by the fall in interest rates that followed the financial crisis. Across the world, interest rates fell considerably, and that did give a large boost to asset prices. So that's what's going on in wealth. As you say, a couple of questions are trying to explore whether that's linked to either the earnings inequality earlier or whether that's linked to slow growth in earnings now. And I don't have good answers on either of those. But those are really interesting questions.
they are indeed. Would therefore Stephen or Janet like to attempt any kind of answer? A very serious shaking of the head from both of them. I think you have our panel stumped, as they might say on a television quiz game. It certainly seems to me. I mean, clearly something. Part of what was going on was that higher levels of income and inequality in the 80s has fed through to some extent into wealth inequality, and clearly very loose monetary policy has pushed up as Mike was saying, asset prices. I think it's harder to think of an immediate relationship between stagnating earnings and growing wealth. But clearly the two of those things together are really what's behind Mike's big conclusion, which is that there's been a change in economic power between generations here. And that's what's, you know, put those two things together. And you've got this, I think, toxic combination where younger generations are losing out because they're struggling to buy assets and becoming worse off than over their lifetime than the older generation. Can we tax wealth? Another rather big question. This is put rather acerbically because MPs hold much of it. We do have the wealthiest prime minister we've ever had, but I don't think that is the key. And maybe it's naive of me. I don't think that is the key. The key problem with taxing wealth. But Mike, you and colleagues have thought about this quite a lot.
Yes, oh, indeed. I'm sure the civil servants are thinking about this right now. As listeners may know, the government is keen to close the gap between tax revenues and public spending. And I'm sure the civil servants will be whipping out their list of cunning wheezes to increase tax revenues. And that will, of course, contain suggestions about to raise more money through wealth taxes or more money from the proceeds of wealth. I mean, and indeed, I think if you were to ask the Resolution Foundation, which is where I work, what do we think should be done with taxation of wealth? Our first port of call is not a straightforward tax on the amount of wealth you have. It is doing something about the way that the returns to some kinds of wealth are undertaxed compared to earnings. One would start with capital gains tax, for example. But what we would also think about, inheritance tax, which I think progress could definitely be made on those. I think I've forgotten exactly who. There was, of course, a wealth tax commission a couple of years ago. I've forgotten exactly who was on it. I think I was associate member of it, which did indeed look at the amount of wealth in the UK, which assessed practical proposals for taxing it and came up with an estimate of how much revenue could be raised. So the ability to do it, I think, is definitely there. But as the question was hinting at, the political will, certainly for the Conservative Party, has not been there. But I think, it is likely we'll see progress first on taxing the returns to some forms of wealth which are undertaxed compared to earnings.
Yeah.
Let me just jump in to say that one thing that I know, and I'm sure many of us have seen, is that there seems to be a resurgence in interest and discussion in wealth taxes across many countries. The number of high-income countries that tax wealth actually fell over time, partly because of political concerns, but also just they seem to be, the way they were often designed, were not efficient. In the United States, a wealth tax was almost always completely off the political table until 2020, when it attracted a lot of very serious attention here. I think the work of Saez and Zucman also has been influential here and in other countries. And they argue that the wealth taxes, many of the ones in Europe that were terminated, were just simply poorly designed, that wealth taxes can be designed to be much more efficient and effective. And there's a new, I think my understanding is that both at the European level and in many countries, there's a resurging interest and popularity of the idea of reintroducing wealth taxes.
Yeah, so I've just underlined Mike's point about taxing the proceeds of wealth. I mean, the general principle is, it's really bad for a tax system when getting your income in different forms has a big effect on what your tax bill is, whether or not you're getting your money in terms of business income or, as Mike says, capital gains, or just those of us getting employment earnings, and can be taxed very differently, and that's inappropriate. So I think that is a very good way in which to start, and one of the most obvious ways that could garner support as well, because as you said, getting political support is really important. And unfortunately, inheritance taxes are really death taxes, or deathly for politicians who introduce them, regardless of whatever merits they seem to have. That's unfortunate. That shouldn't how it be, but it seems to play out that way. One other form of tax reform, which would be appropriate, certainly from a fairness point of view, and would be involving taxing wealth itself, would be a reform of the our local property taxes, currently the council tax rate, which is, you know, to try and explain it to Janet would be, you know, take ages, and it would be really hard, but it's really weird, and that would be a great place to start. But again, because since nothing has been done for so long, it'd be really hard to do it. So I'm with Mike. Tax of proceeds of wealth is the place to start.
Let me just add one more point, if I could, and I agree with that. That's a conversation here that we tax capital income much less than labor income, and that introduces all kinds of inequality. I know in the United States, I think that when we talk about taxing wealth, there's been an overemphasis. People are equating that with estate taxes here, or estate and inheritance taxes. And I learned a few years ago something that a lot of wealth and mobility scholars knew long before I did. And that is, of course, there's a strong intergenerational correlation. There's a strong correlation between parental wealth and the wealth of their adult children. But that correlation is in place before the bequesting takes place. And so it's, in other words, it's before the bequesting takes place. So when mom and dad have a lot of wealth, you know, little Johnny and Sally have all kinds of other benefits, higher education, big issue in the United States, of course, you know, elite schools, higher income, accumulating their own wealth. So it's really mistaken that we can solve this breaking the intergenerational link solely through the estate taxes, partly because longevity, people are getting their, you know, people are receiving their inheritances in their 50s. And that wealth, you know, that persistence of wealth is already in place. So I think that that's something we're sort of realizing here, that thinking about taxing wealth has to take place through other mechanisms.
Yeah, sorry, we're talking about this a while, but it's an important point. I agree with everything that people said. And I mean, the key thing about taxing wealth in the UK is we need to fix the wealth taxes we've got. I mean, capital gains tax, as has been suggested, is absurdly generous, both often in its rate and certainly in its annual allowance on top of the income tax allowance, although we ought to index for price inflation. Inheritance tax is hopeless, incredibly easy to avoid if you've got lots of money. A former tax lawyer who was a partner at one of the major firms, who wrote a little guide to avoiding inheritance tax if you've got additional money. He says, take your additional money that's not in your home, sell your assets, buy something in the alternative investment market, live for 2 years, and Bob's your uncle. That's it. You've avoided inheritance tax. Alternatively, you can just give it to your kids if you're before you die, or you buy farmland or what have you. If all of your assets are in your pension and house, which for most people on middling kinds of wealth they are, it's much harder. And that relates to, I think, the issue around wealth taxes as such. 80% or thereabouts of household wealth in the UK is in owner-occupied housing and pensions. I think not only would it be politically difficult, I think it would be economically disruptive and arguably morally dodgy to start taking significant percentages of that from most people. And people, when talk about wealth taxes, they often have two very different things in mind. A wealth tax on all wealth starting at £500,000 would raise a lot of money, but it would be staggeringly disruptive and I think a non-starter. Something starting at £5 million, i.e. much more than I've got, would be much more welcome and a very different kind of tax. The other options are whether this is one-off or whether this is repeated year on year. And again, those are very different kinds of tax. And I think when you just hear the phrase wealth tax, it's really important to be clear which of those we're talking about. We've got a few minutes left and an awful lot of questions. So I'm now going to start looking up and down rather than just taking whatever comes next. I mean, there's an interesting question here about the role of women's work. Mike, obviously over time, more women have been in work, and that's affected the sort of household distribution of income. But there's a question here is really about women taking time out of work and how that affects the overall distribution of income. Can you just tell us something about what's been happening to income inequality as a result of changing labour market behaviour among women?
Yes, I think I can. Yes. So the long run trends are, as we say, for women to be more women to be in work for longer, be more likely to work full time. There's much less of a dip in labor force participation during the child rearing years now than there would have been several decades ago. That has complicated effects on income inequality, to be honest. It depends whereabouts these women are in the income or earnings distribution and who they're partnered to. We do look at this in some detail in the back of the report. I mean, what we show is that probably in the most recent years, this is acting to the increased employment of women is probably acting to increase inequality pressures for most of the distribution, because working women, full time working women, tend to live with full time working men, so we have this. People talk about a polarization of work between full-time working men tend to live with full-time working women, and it's also the case that amongst women, you're more likely to have a partner if you're working than if you're not working. Both of those together mean that you've got a sort of stretching out between women not working, maybe living by themselves, women working full-time, living with full-time working men. So that pressure is, if anything, pushing inequality up. In terms of the generational differences, we do have that split down by gender in our report. And there, I think what the question was hinting at, to the fact that women are more likely to work now is helping prevent recent generations of women from being worse off than their predecessors. So that generational picture I showed you, where recent birth cohorts are sort of no better off than their predecessors, that looks even worse for men, but better for women. And that is because women now are more likely to work in their 30s and 40s.
Could I jump in with something there?
Please do. Yeah.
In the interest of a little bit of disagreement. I don't think I would have to say I see that rather differently, Mike. And I've done actually quite a bit of work on this myself and also edited a volume in which there's a lot of work on this. The question about the impact of women's rising attachment to the labor force on inequality across households, like everything, I know this is going to sound a bit of a cop-out, it really depends on what years you're looking at, what you're measuring, and what's the counterfactual. If you're looking at women's employment, oftentimes the counterfactual is women are out of the labor force as opposed to, you know, some other counterfactual. But my understanding of the literature is that overall, between 1980 and present, women's increasing earnings have actually compressed inequality across households because, in fact, for two reasons, one is that the bottom has risen more than the top has risen. And I think also that the story of homogamy or assortative mating, where high earning women are partnered with high earning men, if that level of assortative mating is extremely high, then indeed, it's going to blow up, women's increasing earnings going to blow up the top of the income distribution. But just to say, the empirical evidence is really not bearing it out in most cases. In fact, in a volume that I edited, Susan Harkness in the UK did a big study of this using the list data and looking at multiple methodological approaches to this. And she finds in almost every country between 1980 and, well, this was done in 2012, that in fact, women's increased earnings was equalizing across households. So I think indeed there are some cases and perhaps some pockets where it might be blowing up the top. But if you look, especially just to say women flipping from zero earnings to positive earnings in recent decades, it's pulled up the bottom and compressed the distribution more than it's increased it. And I think the OECD studies find the same, if I may say so.
Do you want to add anything, Stephen?
No.
Great. I think this is probably one for Janet as much as anything, which is really, are there any examples from particularly other countries where inequalities have narrowed? And if so, have we got any lessons we can draw from that?
Yes. I think the interesting finding, perhaps another way to say it, is that inequality, again, if we look at about 1980 up until whenever we have our most recent data, and the rising inequality mostly appeared in the early 1980s in most of the high income countries. I think the one important thing to say is that in about two thirds of the countries, inequality rose. In the other third, it was either flat with a few declines. This may not be what the questioner was thinking about, but one of the most interesting stories, virtually all the countries in Latin America between 1980 and 2000, inequality fell in, I think, 18 out of 19 countries in Latin America. Interestingly enough, that was because almost entirely because the bottom rose. It wasn't because of tamping down on inequality at the top, and the bottom rose, mostly because the percentage of people who were working in formal labor rose and then were covered by earnings protections and then also by pensions and so forth. So the Latin American cases in some very fast growing countries were marked for a period of two decades by falling inequality. We also saw periods of time in France and in some of the Nordic countries where inequality is falling during, it depends on really what years you're looking at. But I think the punchline of that is that national policies matter, and they matter a lot. And they're very time specific and they're country specific. So the things we think of as driving up inequality, globalization, rise of technology, those are global forces. But in fact, the patterns are shaped very much by the regulation of earnings and the patterns of redistribution within countries and within points in time.
Yeah, I mean that's exactly the point you could make about the UK even as well. I mean, the most recent example talk about the pre-distribution market incomes, Janet. Well, the inequality of men's earnings, which notoriously has been increasing substantially, the increase has actually been falling off because earnings at the bottom have been increasingly got a floor set by what's called the national living wage, national minimum wage, which is essentially jacking up what's going on at the bottom, and that's having a noticeable effect on inequality in the earnings distribution. And of course, it has to interact with other stuff to what you get out. And the other lesson, seeing as we're talking about 3 to 5 decades going back, is that inequality in the UK of income, household income inequality, did fall between when the first surveys out there at the beginning of the 60s through to mid to late 70s, which was a period I wasn't in the country, but my understanding was that there was wages and income policy of various kinds. Mike and Paul can elaborate on this, but that was certainly a period when inequality went down. And that tallies also essentially with what's been happening in France and in Belgium to a lesser extent in the decline.
I think that's also a lesson for the fact that declining inequality is not always an indication of nirvana, which I don't think was a good description of the UK in the 1970s.
No, quite. There was lots of other stuff going on we're revisiting at the moment.
Indeed, we may see more of that in coming years. I mean, it's really interesting what you're saying there, Stephen. I think it's clearly true that governments affect inequality, and I mean in very broad brush terms, one of the things in Mike's chapter, I think, broadly says is that if you look through the 2000s, then government policy in terms of raising tax credits in particular acted against the growth in market inequality to keep inequality under control. And if you look over the 2010s, it was rather the reverse. Market inequality, if anything, fell partly because of the minimum wage policy that Stephen's talking about, but cuts in benefits pulled it the other way, so that the institutions around minimum wages, but also the policies around taxes and benefits matter. Although clearly, ideally, we would have other instruments as well. And one of our struggles is that our other instruments we haven't made a great deal of use of, or indeed find quite difficult to use.
Could I just add one sentence to say, if we're curious, if we want to see how much public policy affects both inequality and poverty, and how directly in many countries, we should take a look at the last 3 years, which we haven't really talked about too much, just because of data limitations. Child poverty in the US fell by half. You know, we did what the UK said it would do in a single year because of the introduction of a child tax credit, which unfortunately was terminated. Same in Canada, and that crashing poverty, not just child poverty, but poverty. Also, we had a big dip in inequality. Well, I think it's all gonna be reversed in the United States because these COVID-related interventions have all been terminated. But it certainly showed you the short causal chain between income transfers and poverty.
There's a really interesting question here around changes in income uncertainty or volatility, different points of the income distribution, whether it's due to increased self-employment or gig work or risky assets. Do everything we've been talking about in terms of income inequality so far has been just looking at, you know, what is the distribution of incomes in the cross section. But clearly it matters both whether people are at one point of that distribution for a long period or whether they're jumping up and down the distribution, and also how uncertain the income that they've got feels to them. I think Stephen, you've thought quite a lot about that.
Yeah, and Mike and I are continuing to talk about it in real time. I mean, it's a very important point, the extent to which there is volatility, shocks to your income, particularly downwards, that you're unable to take account of, not happening. I mean, international, two points. One is that research to date, including for the UK, but especially for the US, would suggest that volatility and the adverse consequences of it are very much experienced by people at the bottom towards rather than at the top. I mean, it's to do with the coping mechanisms that people do or do not have. The second and rather unfortunate point to report is that we do not have up-to-date information about this. In particular, most of the information that we have, and most recently Mike's been working on this, is the changes in volatility for between 1 year and the next. But in fact, what's really important is, I think, the short-term changes, whether from week to week, fortnight to fortnight, or month to month. And at the moment, there's a lot of interest in this, but it's difficult to put our hands on it. We're looking for it.
Mike, do you want to add to that?
The reason it wasn't covered in detail in this chapter is because there isn't data of as good a quality as we do for sort of income, static incomes, and so I don't think we can really say whether the volatility or uncertainty is getting worse over time, over long periods of time. We do, of course, know about the kind of employment contract that different people have, whether they're permanent or temporary, and whether they are zero-hours contracts or not. And those we know and those are slanted towards the young, and they're going to be slanted towards low-wage people. But of course, those contracts may be associated with greater changes, but that doesn't always mean that that's undesirable volatility. A zero-hours contract could be stable, or it could reflect people's preferences. You know, it doesn't necessarily have to be the volatility in a harmful sense. So it is definitely an active research agenda. For the UK, there's definitely poor internationally comparable data, but it's one that Stephen and I are hopeful to make some progress over the next few years.
We've only got a couple of minutes left. Is there anything any of you would like to add? And in particular, there's a whole slew of other questions there. Rather than me choosing them, is there anything that any of you would like to answer? You don't feel you have to.
Let me just emphasise one thing, that another way of expressing what Mike said is that often we've looked at inequality in income or wealth, but done it separately. And I think one of the things that comes out from Mike's and colleagues' report is that actually it's the joint distribution of income and wealth that's been changing over time. The like, in particular, if most people hold their wealth in housing, so creation, that striking chart about the relationship between income and wealth just underlines it. Those changing relationships. And so it's not just inequality per se, but potentially toxic combinations combined with the horizontal inequalities by age, sex, and as you'll see, by ethnic minority group and so on. I think it's the combination of all these different things that is increasingly a worry.
I would just add, if I could, I guess a last reflection. I didn't say anything about this in my presentation, but wrote just a little bit in my commentary, a plug for cross-national research as an instrument for policy analysis, that obviously when we look across countries and over time, you know, it gives us the opportunity to observe policy conditions that we don't observe in our own country, the natural experiments abound. And the literature, there have been about 800 papers coming out of LIS already over the last many years, and of course, similarly out of all the other inequality databases. I think the big questions that people are asking now is, are disaggregating taxes from transfers in terms of their inequality and poverty mitigation, and disaggregating transfers. And the age-old question, the oldest question in welfare state research and sociology, is about universal versus targeted benefits, and which are the most effective in reducing inequality and poverty. And the consensus in the literature, of course, is, I think most of you have heard the idea of targeting within universalism. But the point being that looking at cross-national data and cross-national research is a really powerful tool to understand exactly what's happening inside the black box of these, you know, over-aggregated things about redistribution. Different transfers have very different effects, and different kinds of taxes and transfers have different effects. And I think that's where the research is going now, into these really granular questions, which have enormous and immediate implications for policy analysis. That doesn't get us past the political barriers, but it gets us into intellectual territory.
Great. Thank you. We should probably end there. Two small adverts on the internet, in international comparisons, as a sort of add-on to this big Deaton review that we're doing. We're also doing a big project on international comparisons of inequality, where with something like 15 different countries, we've got a template where we'll get hopefully directly comparable measures of inequality, and also asking them to do deep dives in particular issues in those countries. And that will probably be a year or more before that comes out, but there's some really interesting work going on there. And secondly, just to repeat what I said at the beginning, Monday, where we'll be looking at inequalities within and between different ethnic minorities, where I think the headline is that there's a huge amount going on there, a lot of change in the UK, and big, big differences between the different ethnic minorities. So do tune in on Monday afternoon. Thank you so much to Mike, to Janet, and to Stephen, and thank you all for listening.